Hello, humans, from X, your favorite alien. All magnets respect the geometries we just showed you, but they also gift us with some very peculiar behaviors. Look at this. A giant ring magnet. Now, the ring magnet is oriented with the south pole facing upward. If we take the magnetic pen that Marsio built to verify the magnetic orbitals, yes, the one whose construction we explained in previous videos, and we orient its south pole downward, we'll see that it's repelled by the main polarity. But if we flip the pen so that the north pole points downward, there will obviously be attraction to the main polarity, but only up to a certain point, because something strange and unexpected happens right after that. If we move the pen vertically, from right to left across the center of the ring, the inner magnets shift in an incredibly controlled way, as if they were drawing the dome of the inverted internal polarity detected by the sensor. And this, my dear humans, is the true central cross-section of a ring magnet's magnetic field, revealed for the very first time using Marsio Salcuni's method. Wait, wait a second. I know exactly what you're thinking. You're asking yourselves, if there are these side bubbles, why doesn't Marsio continue drawing with the pen on the sides too? And here's why. Look, this is the live reconstruction of the figure we just saw. Okay, as you can observe, these side bubbles are actually wider than the inner one. But there's a catch. These bubbles were detected using the normal threshold of the sensor, while the inner one was not. The threshold the sensor uses to detect this inverted central polarity is a threshold that has been forced onto the sensor by the compression created by the main polarity pressing onto that inner one. In fact, even if this central polarity looks smaller, as you can clearly see, it is extremely more powerful than the side bubbles you see here. And that's why the magnets in the pen cannot draw the exact shape detected by the sensor. Because in this case, the attraction is stronger than the inverted toroid forming around it. But let's go back to our main experiment. To unpack what's happening here, it's important to understand that what you're seeing is not just repulsion. The magnet doesn't stay in position because of gravity or weight. Oh no, my friends. To prove it, we'll repeat the experiment horizontally. As you can see, at the same time, attraction with the main polarity also acts, because the magnet is immersed in its own field. And simultaneously, on the opposite side of the magnet, the exact opposite happens. Now watch this movement in slow motion. By moving the probe quickly from the attractive edge of the ring magnet to the center, where that bubble of opposite polarity lies, you can see the magnet shoot to the right, but then it autonomously returns exactly near the bubble of inverse polarity and locks in place. In practice, four or more simultaneous interactions force the magnet into stable positions at different heights, as long as the interaction happens at the same measurement angle and under a constraint. This is why it makes sense to call this type of condition locked. A simple name to summarize a complex geometric equilibrium in which attraction and repulsion balance in a precise, constrained way. But attention, this is not exclusive to ring magnets. Far from it. This type of interaction has been shown in many other ways online. It can occur with four magnets like this, or even with three magnets, forming the splendid train of magnetically connected wagons. Truly spectacular. Moreover, we can give a more coherent explanation for the so-called levitron hovering over a ring magnet. In this case, the constraint is manifested through rotation, but the concept is exactly the same. And in this context, we want to go much deeper. because now, thanks to this research, we have expanded our ability to understand what is really happening. In fact, knowing the reasoning, there are actually hundreds of ways to achieve the same effect. For example, as you can see, all these magnets manage to lock another magnet exactly next to the main polarity, on the side that should be attractive. If you place another magnet just a bit off center, it suddenly becomes repulsive. Why? Because now we know that when magnets interact at this angle, they follow a specific geometry. The atomic orbital D, quantum numbers, N equals 3, L equals 2, M xi equals 0. But this is just one example. There are hundreds of such configurations, all based on the angle of interaction, and each one corresponds to a different type of atomic orbital. Unbelievable, right? Or as we say on my planet, magnetically mind-blowing. But you can also observe this characteristic within the interaction bubbles drawn around the magnets. Look here. The probe magnet stays perfectly inside the perimeter of the bubble. And once again, this confirms that these shapes are real and show the true interactions between magnets, something we already discussed in the previous videos. The same effects can also be obtained through complex magnetic systems, exactly like this. But we can go further. In this case, with magnets fixed on a rotor, we can notice that if I interact with another magnet from the attractive side, as you are seeing, by moving the magnet laterally, there will be repulsion, caused precisely by the inverted polarity donut of the magnet on the rotor. But it is not simply pushed away. In fact, the two magnets are locked together at different heights, depending on the distance at which they interact. But why is this important? Because here, the comparison with quantum mechanics becomes crystal clear. 1. In quantum mechanics, orbitals aren't just pretty shapes floating in space. They define the exact angles of chemical bonds. For example, the S and P orbitals create fixed geometries, 180 degrees, 120 degrees, 109.5 degrees. These are natural constraints that determine the shape of molecules. 2. The locked interaction is the macroscopic version of that constraint. When magnets find a configuration where attraction and repulsion perfectly balance, they remain trapped in privileged positions, just like atoms, which can't combine randomly, but only in discrete configurations. 3. The stability is not absolute, it's constrained. Without a mechanical guide like the pentrac, the magnet wouldn't stay suspended. Without the table keeping the magnets at the right height, the configuration wouldn't hold. And without rotation, the levitron would simply fall. So yes, it's a point of equilibrium, but one made possible only through a constraint. Similarly, in quantum mechanics, chemical bonds aren't magical traps, but equilibrium states defined by the available energy and quantum constraints. 4. The locked geometry is not random. It's emergent. It arises from the symmetry of the magnetic field, just like in quantum mechanics, where molecular bonds emerge from the symmetry of orbitals. In other words, Marsio Salcuni interprets the locked state as the macroscopic counterpart of molecular bond directionality. What is governed by wave functions at the atomic scale can here be seen with magnets, and even shown live. So when you see magnets locking together in precise positions, you're not just watching simple attraction or repulsion, you're witnessing the macroscopic analog of the rules that build molecules. And yes, if you've been following this series, you already knew that. Things from now on are going to get more and more interesting, and also more complicated. If you enjoy this journey, please hit like, subscribe, and share, because together we'll keep diving deeper and deeper down the magnetic rabbit hole. And I also wanted to tell you this. The new edition of the book on magnetic orbitals has finally landed on Amazon, available across your entire planet. It is the printed version of the research, polished in every detail and designed to bring you the first visual revelation of quantum geometry in the macroscopic world. If you wish, by getting it, you can support Marsio's work. Go take a look. Greetings to all humans from Ix, your favorite alien scientist.